Bryant at ISU. Today, the Bradley captain tries to shoot the Braves to their first win in 2 weeks. ISU is shooting to stay in the Valley race and win the season's first matchup with its I-74 rival from Peoria. ISU and Bradley, up next on News Channel 31 Sports.
Welcome to Illinois State Redbird Basketball.
The best rivalry in the Missouri Valley Conference turns 100 years old this week. And today, for the 99th time in series history, Bradley and ISU do battle here at Redbird Arena. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Redbird Arena for Illinois State and Bradley here on News Channel 31 Sports. Kirk Pegler, Matt Taphorn with you. Matt, a pair of teams headed in opposite directions right now. The Braves have lost 3 in a row, but they have arguably the best player in the conference in Marcellus Somerville.
Without question, the junior from Peoria Central, averaging nearly 18 points a ball game, 7 rebounds, second in the league in scoring, is probably the most complete player in the league. At 6'7", can step out on the floor and shoot the three, and is big and strong enough, he'll go in and battle you on the boards and score inside. He'll certainly be a tough matchup for the Redbirds today.
ISU coming home after a very successful road trip in which they won 3 of 4 games away from normal, and one of the big reasons why they're surging is senior guard Trey Guidry.
Without question, Guidry's kind of come out of his midseason slump, really hit some big shots for the Redbirds, averaging nearly 20 points a game over a stretch of 4 games in those Redbird victories. One of the 3 senior guards who's really stepped it up for the Redbirds.
Settle in, the starting lineups and the opening tip is up next. Bradley and ISU here on News Channel 31 Sports.
Illinois State Redbird Basketball on WMBD is sponsored by Country Insurance and Financial Service. Real people, real answers, real quick. Mail Plumbing, Heating and Air Conditioning, your carrier dealer. And Whitaker's Country Oak Shop, your home for quality oak furniture.
It's the final week of the Ultimate Indoor Auto Sale. Monday.
Visiting the Braves, who, as we mentioned, will start Marcellus Somerville, one of the top players in the league, along with Patrick O'Brien, Tony Bennett, Jeremy Crouch, and Daniel Ruffin. 3 of those 5 are freshmen. Illinois State will counter with the same 5 that's really done the bulk of the starting work for Porter Moser's team. Lorenzo Gordon, Greg Alexander, Greg Dillegard, Vince Green, and Trey Guidry. 3 of those 5 are senior guards. The Braves are coached by Jim Less in his third season. 38 wins and 42 losses. The Braves, with Coach Less, won both games during the regular season last year against the Redbirds. Illinois State, coached by Porter Moser. 25 wins, 25 losses in his second year with the Redbirds. If you count his 3 previous years at Arkansas Little Rock, his 5-year overall record, 79 and 59. This is the 99th meeting in the all-time series. Bradley leads the all-time series 54-44. The 100th anniversary of the series. 100 years ago yesterday, ISU and Bradley met for the first time, February the 4th, 1905, with the Redbirds winning that first matchup 39-13. First time in 7 years, Matt, that we've had a sellout crowd here, and it's electric in here.
Well, it certainly is, and a lot of that has to do with how well the Redbirds have played on the road as of late, and just the feeling amongst Redbird fans that they're starting to turn the corner here, starting to really buy into what Coach Porter Mosier has pushed into them for the last 2 years, and it really starts with those three senior guards. You mentioned the fact that Bradley has three freshmen. That's a huge difference, especially when you're playing on the road, and they just have not been able to get it done on the opponent's floor in the Missouri Valley.
In fact, Bradley is one of only three teams in the country to start three freshmen, or actually to have three freshmen that are averaging better than 20 minutes per game. So the Braves have a very young lineup, and the Redbirds have a veteran lineup to start this game. Robert Staffen, Tim Hutchinson, and Paul Castor are the three officials working the game. Bradley in its road red uniforms with white and black trim. The Redbirds in their home whites with red and black trim. And we are just about ready to get underway here. We mentioned the Redbirds are back home after a very successful road trip, and the Braves are spinning their tires a little bit, having lost three in a row. Greg Dillegard to jump against Patrick O'Brien, the 7-foot freshman out of Minnesota. And the tip is controlled by the Redbirds. Vince Green gets it in the backcourt, and we are underway. The first meeting of the year between the Redbirds and the Braves. You remember last year, Bradley won both regular season contests, and then ISU won the Missouri Valley Conference opener game on Friday in St. Louis of last year. Stepped out of bounds, the Redbirds have turned it over.
And certainly Lorenzo Gordon's going to draw a lot of attention from Bradley defensively, averaging nearly 18 points a ball game. Patrick O'Brien was following him closely. O'Brien is 7 foot, has a much longer wingspan, very tough defensively, leads the Valley in block shots.
Daniel Ruffin guarded by Greg Alexander. Backdoor pass to Bennett. Reverse layup, no good. Redbirds did a nice job of contesting that shot.
Good one-handed pass that time by Ruffin from off the top. And Bennett very quick at guard. And only 6 foot again, one of the newcomers in this rivalry.
Yeah, four newcomers in that Bradley starting five when you count Bennett as a junior college transfer. Now it's Alexander's three. That's good.
And that's what we've seen from Greg Alexander in the games that we've done, is the fact that he's really stepping into that shot, snapping into it, and he saw that even from 2 or 3 feet behind the three-point line.
Well, he appears to be completely recovered from an ankle injury that sidelined him for a couple of games earlier this year. Here's O'Brien down low working on Gordon. He rolls it in.
That was a planned play that time. Somerville drew a lot of attention coming through the lane. They threw over the top to O'Brien. That was a secondary option.
Great energy here in the opening minutes of this basketball game. Gordon couldn't get the short shot to go down. Ruffin clears.
Gordon really had the inside track that time on the block against O'Brien. Just wasn't able to get his footing and get the ball up the basket. Good shot opportunity, just wasn't able to convert.
O'Brien, floater, a little hook shot that goes down. Patrick O'Brien has all four of the Bradley points.
Seeing some of the versatility of O'Brien as well. Scores in close to the basket, nice little jump hook. Very effective. His problem has been foul trouble in this season.
Gordon draws a triple team, and he's going to get to the free throw line.
And that's going to be a tough matchup for O'Brien. He's got Gordon down low, who is certainly the focus of the Illinois State offense. And that's one of the weaknesses O'Brien has had in this season, is getting into foul trouble early in the ballgame, taking himself out of the game. And we're going to see a substitution already for O'Brien.
So O'Brien picks up the foul. Brandon Heemskirk ready to check in. And Lorenzo Gordon at the free throw line. This is a luxury that few teams in the Missouri Valley have ever been able to afford. Yeah, one 7-footer goes to the bench and another 7-footer comes in the game. Earlier this year, in fact, when Jim Less had Patrick O'Brien and Brandon Heemskirk on the floor at the same time, we believe it was the first time in Valley history that they had two 7-footers on one team on the same floor at the same time. Gordon didn't get either free throw to go down. It's still 4-3 Braves.
No, and Gordon's been a very effective free throw shooter on the season. Just maybe a little nervous energy here in the early start of the ball game.
Here's Bennett with Guidry on him. Lost the dribble out to Ruffin. Now Somerville. Kick out to Ruffin. Seven on the shot clock. Guidry guards him. His pull-up three is no good. Heemskerk, the offensive board.
Redbirds did a great job defensively of really battling Braves, and they get an offensive rebound, but now the Redbirds really fought for that possession and got the ball back.
Bennett's first shot is no good, and ISU walks the ball back up the floor with a chance to reclaim the lead. Guidry, his first shot of the game is a three. It's no good. Somerville back to get the board.
A little bit of a forced shot that time by Guidry. Didn't really have his shoulders squared as he jumped in that shot, but he's been very hot lately. Wanted to see if he had it going early.
Crouch looks into Somerville. Gets it to Somerville, who's guarded by Dillegard on the baseline. Now Crouch sees a little seam, works the baseline, missed the shot. It's Heemskerk there, and he laid it in.
Boy, and you had Gordon and Greg Alexander just ran right into each other that time. Gordon came over defensively to help out on the drive by Crouch and really ran over Greg Alexander. And Heemskerk gets the easy lay-in off the offensive rebound.
All six of the Bradley points have come off the hands of seven-footers. Four from O'Brien, two from Heemskerk. Here's Guidry, double team. Now it's Dillegard. 10 on the shot clock. Redbirds work it over to Vince Green for three. It's no good.
Usually early in the ball game, especially with the type of energy that we see in this game.
It's going to be a reach-in foul on the Redbirds, and of course the fans here do not like that call from Paul Castor.
I'll complete that thought in a minute.
Early on in the ball game, Bradley leads ISU 6-3.
At Heritage Bank, we're defined not by what...
Found that three-point stroke in recent games.
Yeah, and he's the only one who's connected for the Redbirds so far in this ball game. And the point I was trying to make before the break there was the Illinois State has taken three of their four shots from beyond the arc. The Braves have only attempted one three-point shot. That was kind of a desperation as the shot clock's winding down. In a game like this, with as much emotion and energy that's in the arena, it's better to try to get your offense established inside, and that's what Bradley's trying to do in the early going. See if the Redbirds try to counter on their end.
And Lawrence Wright has entered the game for the first time for the Braves. He's been a terrific sixth man off the bench. That's him. He hangs and fires and scores on his first shot.
And that's one thing Lawrence Wright really brings to the Bradley team is a lot of energy off the bench, very explosive off the floor, both on the offensive end and on the boards.
He's very long, long arms, long legs. He's got a 7-foot wingspan. Here's Guidry. Hangs. Floats it. It's good.
Good decision that time by Guidry. Didn't settle for the three-point shot. Knew his defender was on his hip. Went to the basket.
And it's going to be a held ball, and that should go to Bradley. So the held ball possession, they'll turn the arrow back around and point it towards the Redbirds as the Braves get it this time. And now Neil Plank comes in to replace Greg Dillegard. Dillegard really did a great job in the first 4 minutes on Marcellus Somerville. Somerville was on the bench briefly. Now he comes back in for Jeremy Kraut.
Well, it's interesting to see how Jim Les countered with that move, because now he puts Somerville back in there to give him a bigger front line. Now you've got Plank guarding Somerville as opposed to having Dillegard, who was very effective in the early going.
Lawrence Wright is going to be called for an offensive foul. It looks like Tim Hutchinson, who made the call, took a spill right in front of Porter Moser.
What hustle by the official on that play. He had the call, was getting excited about making it. Greg Alexander did such a good job of taking that charge, he really knocked out the official on the play.
It may not have been caught by our cameras, but Tim Hutchinson, the official who made that call, stumbled right in front of the Redbird bench and actually made the call from his backside. The Redbirds get it now. It's Guidry. He gets it to Plank. Shot is no good. Tipped out, and it's controlled by the Braves. Bennett comes back in the front court.
Guidry does a great job of picking him up, transition defense. That's one thing Guidry has done very well this season, is picked it up on the defensive end.
Keemskirk inside. He may have walked. He did.
Yes, he did. And you can see with this lineup on the floor, with Heemskirk, Somerville, and Lawrence Wright, the Braves are looking to attack the basket inside even more so than they did in early going. Gordon and Greg Dillegard both on the bench.
And now Nadu Oniyuku is going to come in for the first time for the Redbirds. He'll replace Greg Alexander, and Ronnie Carwell goes back to the bench in favor of Lorenzo Gordon. Full court pressure shown by Bradley now.
Now we'll have Heemskirk guarding Lorenzo Gordon inside, see if the Redbirds take it right to him.
Offensive foul, Nadu Oniyuku. That time the 7-footer Heemskirk took the charge.
Yeah, I like to see the aggressive action there by Oniyuku, really taking it to the basket. In that situation, he really needs to pull up, try to get that short jumper. He had Lorenzo Gordon on the right block as well. But I like seeing that out of Nadu coming off the bench.
Last couple of weeks, Brandon Heemskirk has really helped his team out. He had a career-high 9 points against Creighton in a loss last Wednesday. And it stretches in that first half that he was on the floor. Jim Les said he was our best player on the floor at the time.
It's one thing the Redbirds have done recently is shown that three-quarters court zone press, and then they fall back into either a zone or man-to-man.
8-5, Bradley. The early lead here on Illinois State. We've played about 6 minutes of action. Kurt Pegler and Matt Taphorn with you from Redbird Arena. The first matchup of the year between Bradley and Illinois State. Lawrence Wright misses, and Neil Plank the board. Oniyuku with it. Now it's Green. Now Guidry around the perimeter behind a screen from Plank. Looks for help. Gets it to Plank. Now it's Green. Kick out. Oniyuku, short. Corner three is short off the front of the rim, and Heemskirk the board.
Boy, good ball movement that time by the Redbirds. Really got everybody involved on the offensive end.
And Lawrence Wright ran out of real estate and stepped on the end line.
A lot of great action here in the early going. Not a very high scoring ball game yet, but these two teams are really laying it on the floor. The Redbirds really going after it, get some good shot opportunities, just aren't able to connect much from the three-point range.
Now there's no doubt there's just a palpable energy in the building. These two teams get together. Patrick O'Brien has come into the game. Danny Adams for the Braves is in the game, and Greg Alexander has re-entered for Illinois State. That's Alexander with it now in Plank at the top of the circle. He's guarded by Somerville. Green, open spot on the floor. His three ball is up and missed, and O'Brien gets the board.
Again, that's 5 out of 8 shot attempts for the Redbirds have come from the three-point line. Just aren't really looking to get the ball in to Gordon at this point, and really with O'Brien with one foul already, certainly would be an opportunity to get him on the bench.
And Marcellus Somerville has his first hoop of the afternoon, and he's given Bradley a 5-point lead, 10-5. And now it's going to be a foul on Somerville.
Good action that time by Neil Plank. That's that slip screen that the Redbirds use so often. They'll have Plank try to come and set a screen on the ball, and instead of executing that screen and coming out on the top, you see Plank just slip right by him. Somerville's got his hand wrapped around him on the backside to pick up the foul.
Trey Guidry has re-entered now for Nadu Oniyuku. J.J. Twy is in for the first time. He comes in the ballgame and sends Tony Bennett back to Jim Les's bench. We played just over 7 minutes here. Bradley with a 10-5 advantage. Didgers. And the ball kind of poke checked out of there by J.J. Twy. All the way down, and it's Twy who's got an opportunity for a three-point play. Twy started the play on the defensive end with a steal and was rewarded on the other end. He's got an opportunity to give Bradley a 13-5 advantage.
Just not very good execution on that ball screen by the Redbirds last time down. Twy really didn't do a lot to come up with that steal. The ball just kind of came to him, and then he does a good job of going up strong at the other end and getting the bucket.
Sophomore from Verona, Missouri, cashes in on the free throw. Bradley's lead is 8 now, 13-5, so the Braves come out with their first punch of the afternoon. And Green turned the basketball over.
See, this is a scenario that you have when you play on your home floor in front of your largest crowd of the year. You have a lot of nervous energy. The Redbirds have not played in front of this type of a home crowd. They've certainly played this in front of a crowd like this on the road. But when it's on your own court, there's a little bit more nervous energy on your part. The Bradley Braves really come in here without that type of pressure and have played much more fluid here in the early going. See if the Redbirds can turn it around.
Here's Adams. He misses the outside jumper. It's Twy in there getting the offensive board. So he's given the Braves a nice lift off the bench. Now it's O'Brien with Gordon on him, and he may have been called for an offensive foul.
Yeah, and he'll go to the bench here again. Again, O'Brien, that situation, kind of a silly foul, but a freshman trying to learn his way. You see the left elbow going into Gordon, clearing his own space. That's an easy call by the official.
Second foul on O'Brien. And a 13-5 Bradley lead.
Il faut parler à voix basse
Redbird Arena. I know, Matt, you said it's been tough sledding on the inside for the Redbirds, one of their few looks in the paint. Trey Guidry scoring there. Most of the other shots have come from the perimeter.
They have. They got 5 out of their 8 shots from the perimeter. That was one opportunity the Redbirds took advantage of in the paint. But really, one of the big problems they're having is on the boards. They're one shot and done for the most part. Braves have an early 10-3 advantage on the boards.
And Greg Dillegard has re-entered the game for the Redbirds. And J.J. Twy comes up with a steal in the backcourt. And it's Somerville who shoots it in. J.J. Twy has really come off the bench and given Bradley a spark here, and it's a 10-point Braves advantage.
And the Redbirds have been very effective in the last 5 ball games in taking care of the basketball. They've had some really silly turnovers here in the last few minutes.
And Gordon drives the lane, missed the shots out of bounds to the Braves. So the leading scorer in the Missouri Valley Conference, and Lorenzo Gordon right now, is 0-for-2 from the field.
Well, you can see on that play, Gordon, I think, is a little frustrated that he hasn't gotten his shot opportunities in the ball game. Really got excited to see himself open coming down the lane like that. Just wasn't able to convert.
Bennett, Crouch, Twy, Rembert, and Somerville are the 5 on the floor for Bradley. It's Guidry, Dillegard, Green, Alexander, and Gordon on the floor for Illinois State.
And Greg Dillegard in the ballgame again for the Redbirds, taking on Somerville. Probably one of the best defenders at his size for the Redbirds.
Somerville's three is no good. The long rebound is corralled by Gidry. Alexander to Gordon, who's immediately double-teamed, and a traveling violation whistled against Lorenzo Gordon.
I'm not so sure about that call. It really seemed like Gordon dribbled the ball as he turned. I think the official watched the feet instead of the ball in that play. Gets called for a travel again. Turnover for the Redbirds. That's six turnovers. You see the good entry pass by Greg Alexander. You see the feet move as the ball's going down, and I think the official caught him for a movement on the feet first. And now Gordon's getting some heat from the officials about keeping his shirt tucked in. They've told him four or five times, and Lorenzo Gordon has a look on his face like there's got to be more important things in this ballgame to worry about than my shirt.
Bennett working on Gidry now. It's Rembert handing back to him. Here's Somerville with Dillegard on him. Works the baseline, stepped out of bounds. No, it's going to be a foul against Dillegard.
That's the second call that's been made after the play is continued that the Redbirds have gotten called on a foul. This time watch Greg Dillegard bumping against Somerville down to the baseline. And that's the call. If Somerville throws the ball away, the foul call is made as opposed to, you know, him being out on the baseline.
Second foul against Dillegard, fourth team foul against the Birds. Both Bradley and ISU have been whistled for 14 fouls, and Vince Green's going to come back in.
Dillegard's second foul, probably a bigger loss defensively for the Redbirds than what O'Brien is defensively for the Braves.
Yeah, because he's been matched up with Somerville. Now it's Plank on Somerville. Somerville spins and lays it up and rolled it in. And a timeout from Porter Moser. It's a 12-point Bradley lead.
And that's just a tough move by Somerville inside immediately. When Dillegard comes out of the ball game, he's much longer defensively, bigger against Somerville inside. As soon as Plank comes in the ball game, they try to take advantage of that and go right to him. Good up and under move, and with the left hand, Somerville knocks in two. He's got 6 points in the ball game.
Well, you ask any coach in the Missouri Valley Conference, and they will tell you that Marcellus Somerville is just a headache to defend because he can score inside, he can score outside, he's long, he's lean, and he just causes so many matchup difficulties.
And he really has recommitted himself this year. He plays a lot harder. And not to say that he didn't play hard last year. He's the leader of this year's team, and he's taken that role upon himself and has really had a great junior season. And that time, he just really would not be denied to get the ball to the basket.
And again, the Braves show full court pressure. And then they back off as Vince Green walks the ball up the floor.
Bird still only with 5 points at the 10-minute mark of the ball game.
Here's Gidry, wide open three in front of the Braves bench.
Better ball movement that time by the Redbirds. It all started with Vince Green being double teamed over on one wing and able to get the ball out of the double team. And Coach Jim Less is really getting on J.J. Twy in that situation, saying you cannot leave Gidry open on the perimeter.
Gidry's three is his 45th three-point make of the year. He has 50 more attempts from the three-point arc than any player on Bradley. 17-8, the Braves lead. We're under 10 minutes to go here in the first half.
Birds going back to more of their matchup zone in this situation. They certainly have to identify the shooters for Bradley. They haven't taken many three-point shots yet in the ballgame, but certainly in this situation, look for that.
Now it's Bennett for three. His shot is no good, and Gidry, the defensive board. Bounce pass up to Plank. Lost it out of his hands. Back to get it is Bennett, and now here come the Braves. Down the lane. He took it right to the rack and laid it in.
Yeah, the Redbirds have a fast break opportunity on one end. Don't convert, and the Braves get it back on the other end.
And Gidry hits the pull-up jumper from the baseline and answers. So Braves, Gidry with the last 5 Redbird points.
Yeah, Braves really looking to push the ball offensively to attack the Redbirds, try to beat them down the floor and get some easy baskets. We saw Bennett do that the last time down the floor.
Nice denial defense by the Redbirds and a steal. It's Gidry that comes away with it now. Now Porter Moser said he did not want to get into a racehorse with the Braves because he thought, in his words, they had a lot of thoroughbreds.
Good inside-out action that time by the Redbirds. Gordon being double-teamed every time he touches the ball down the block, as he will against most teams in the league. Plank got the open shot, just wasn't able to convert. Again, the Birds, 6 out of their 11 field goal attempts are from three-point range. 7 out of 12, excuse me.
course, Greg Dillegard is on the bench right now with two fouls for the Birds. Somerville's turnaround jumper is no good. Tipped out to Plank.
Oh, boy, that's a tough pass for a big guy in the open court to handle.
Now it's Alexander. His open three is short. He tries to go and get, and it's over the back of the backboard, I believe. Yeah, that's what they're saying.
Alexander kind of labored into that shot a little bit more. We didn't see the same type of snap into the shot action that we've seen of him lately and him being so effective from three-point range.
Well, he really knew immediately when it was off his hands, he knew it didn't feel right because he went right to the ball trying to get the offensive rebound because he just knew that as he let go of that ball, it wasn't on target.
It was really kind of an awkward transition all along for the Redbirds. Neil Plank got the ball, which Plank is very good at handling the ball, but he gave the ball in transition to Gordon as opposed to letting him get set up down on the block.
Dillegard, or I should say Ronnie Carwell and Onyuko are in the game right now for Illinois State. They've replaced Gordon and Alexander. Here's Brandon Heemskerk. Somerville saw him and got the ball to Heemskerk, who scored his fourth point of the game.
And a good pass in that situation by Somerville as well. He's double team on the block, looks right to the basket for the seven-footer Heemskerk. Trey Guidry a little late getting over on the play defensively.
Onyuku drives. His pass intended for Plank is picked off. It's Ruffin that comes away with it.
Redbirds continue to make or try to make the difficult pass as opposed to the easy pass.
Somerville's baseline jumper's no good. Bennett got position. He missed the short shot. And Nadu Onyuku comes away with it for Illinois State.
I think Guidry may have gotten away with one there over the back on the second shot opportunity that time by Bennett. Good offensive rebound.
Vince Green's shot is no good. Tipped out to Ruffin. Ruffin nearly lost it, and now he did. Green comes away after Plank got his hand on the ball. Plank works the baseline, runs into Heemskerk, flipped it up, and somehow it's dunked in by Ronnie Carwell.
That certainly has electrified this crowd. You got to give Carwell credit for not giving up on the play. He trailed all along, stayed with him, was able to get the lay-in.
Heemskerk's foul line jumper, Brandon Heemskerk, with 6 points off the Braves bench.
That really breaks the defense's back when you get a guy like that at 7 foot that can step to the free throw line when you're trying to deny Somerville the ball inside, and he can knock down that big shot.
With Patrick O'Brien on the bench with two fouls, Heemskerk's really stepped up big. Now Green for three.
Great screen in action inside by the Redbirds that time. You said Daniel Ruffin was on the floor after the screen. But outstanding pass by Nadu Onyuku. Really led it right to Vince Green to knock down the big shot.
Timeout Bradley. The Braves lead Illinois State 23-15.
Just that sentiment. She sees her team as an emotional bridge between the insular world her patients knew in combat and the potentially overwhelming one they're returning to.
We're getting them ready to go back into society and communicate, and there'll be a lot of people asking them questions, so we hold a lot in their lives to be able to get them to readjust, and they appreciate their little time here.
For every flight that leaves Scott Air Force Base with homebound patients, 3 to 4 more come in each week. But it's the unpredictable ebb and flow of battles thousands of miles from here and the seriousness of the wounds that dictate how many troops arrive into the hands of the 375th. For NPR News, I'm Kevin Lavery.
One of the country's largest facilities for breeding and selling dogs and cats for research is out of business. To close their kennels in Arkansas and pay a $250,000 penalty to the USDA. The couple had been charged with numerous violations of the Animal Welfare Act. Arkansas Democrat Gazette reporter Linda Satter joins me now from Little Rock. Welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Can you first tell me about the Baird's business? To whom did they sell and how many animals?
Apparently they sold animals to research facilities all across the country. And this would
allow the Birds come away with it. 3-on-2 if they hurry. Green to Alexander for three. He missed it, and it's Ruffin that comes away with it. And now the Braves have the numbers. It's 4-on-2, and Jeremy Crouch's three is no good. It's back and forth, back and forth.
Now Green to Ford. His pass intended for Gordon is picked off. Now Ruffin in the front court. Ferocious end-to-end action. And Daniel Ruffin's going to get a couple of free throws out of it.
Foul against Vince Green on that play. Boy, Lorenzo Gordon has got to be so frustrated on the floor. The last two times he's run the floor in a press situation, a fast break, and he has not gotten the ball.
And there you see the drive that got a couple of foul shots coming for Daniel Ruffin. So right now the Braves with a 23-17 advantage. That last sequence, Matt, back and forth, back and forth. It's probably, again, not the kind of game Porter Moser says he really doesn't necessarily want to get into any sort of a thoroughbred racehorse meet
but
here.
Again, I think in this situation, this wasn't the play I was thinking of. This is one when Vince Green really splits the defense down the middle and was able to lay in or knock down a shot inside. But the next two transition plays down the floor, Vince Green had Lorenzo Gordon on the right really running hard down the floor. But each time he went to the left, Greg Alexander misses a three, which, you know, every now and then you're going to miss those shots. It's a great shot opportunity. And then Dana Ford gets the ball and tries to force it into Gordon. But each time the big guy's running the floor, and you got to get it to him, especially in a game where Gordon has not scored a basket from the field because on the half-court set he's drawn so much attention from the Braves.
We remind you that this copywritten telecast is presented by the authority of Illinois State University and WMBD-TV. It may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form without the express written consent of Illinois State University and WMBD-TV. Kurt Pegler, Matt Taphorn with you at Redbird Arena, the 99th all-time meeting between Interstate 74 rivals Bradley and Illinois State, the first of their two scheduled regular season meetings. You recall last year that they met three times because there were two regular season meetings and then a meeting in the Missouri Valley Conference Tournament as well.
I tell you, people looked at this game and said, well, Bradley's really struggling right now. Lost three in a row. Illinois State's really playing at a high. Hey, you got to throw that out because Jim Les has been involved in these games many times. He is going to get his team pumped up for this ball game. And you can tell that in the first half of this game, they've really come out fired up. Illinois State has been back on their heels a little bit, and they just have not been able to execute when they've been given the opportunities. They have nine turnovers in the first half, and they've been doing such a great job of taking care of the ball in the last five ball games, and they just have made so many, you know, poor decisions on the offensive end with the ball.
Well, the fans know better. The fans that know about this rivalry know how intense it is, and you can, as you always say, cliche, throw the records out the window when these two squads meet. Ruffin makes good on his first free throw. He's a 75% foul shooter. Freshman from Peoria Central High School. He makes them both. He goes to the bench in favor of J.J. Twy.
I touched on the fact that Gordon has not scored yet in the ball game. He does not get frustrated that easily, though, because we've seen games where, in fact, in the last game at Wichita, he was scoreless in the first half and scored the next 14 points in the first half. So he's really going to go after it any chance he gets.
Here's the double team as Lawrence Knight comes over to help, and it's Dana Ford. Nicely done.
Great job that time by Gordon, realizing he was being double teamed. He saw out of his corner of his eye that Dana Ford was not being guarded. Instead of forcing a three-point shot, Dana attacks the basket and gets the easy lay-in.
That's a terrific pass for the guy who leads the league in scoring and is counted on to score to recognize the double team and get an assist on the play. We approach the four-minute mark left here in the opening half, a six-point Braves lead. It's Heemskerk again.
Yeah, that's off a high screen that time. Greg Alexander did not help on the screen, and Gordon really was a little late getting through it. Again, the Birds poorly in executing that defensively, but the Braves do a good job of really executing what they want to try to get done offensively.
And Brandon Heemskerk with 8 points is the leading scorer in the game. He's whistled for a foul on the perimeter, which is going to be his second. But that's a guy that averages 2.2 points a game, and right now Jim Les already has eight out of him. And his team leads Illinois State 27-19.
Deficit. I'm Craig Windham, NPR News in Washington.
From NPR News, this is All Things Considered. I'm Jennifer Ludden. You may or may not be among the estimated 140 million Americans who plan to watch the Eagles and the Patriots in the Super Bowl tomorrow. Even if you're not, you'll understand there's considerable interest in the halftime show after last year's infamous wardrobe malfunction. The National Football League is doing all it can to avoid a repeat tomorrow in Jacksonville, as NPR's Tom Goldman reports.
To recap, last year's halftime show featured a bump and grind performance by Janet Jackson and Justin Timberlake. Ended with the
hand world. No furniture.
Wardrobe malfunction. Conspiracy theorists said it was a well-planned flash of Janet Jackson's right breast. Accident or not, it generated over 500,000 complaints to the FCC, prompted a congressional hearing, and some say started a debate in this country over culture and moral values that ultimately influenced a presidential election. For a shell-shocked NFL, cleaning up the mess meant first and foremost reclaiming the halftime.
Back here at Illinois State, here's that very fine pass. We mentioned that Lorenzo Gordon threw a double team. He found the open Dana Ford.
Well, again, in this situation with Dana Ford being in the ballgame, he's really not as effective from the three-point range, but does a good job of getting to the basket, going up strong. Jeremy Crouch probably anticipating more of a perimeter offensive opportunity, and Dana Ford was able to slip in behind him.
Greg Alexander, Trey Guidry, Vince Green, Neil Plank, and Lorenzo Gordon are the five on the floor for Illinois State. Marcellus Somerville, Brandon Heemskirk, Tony Bennett, Lawrence Wright, and J.J. Twy, the quintet for Bradley. The Braves lead it 27-19, under 4 minutes to go here opening half. Guidry works the baseline. Shot contested by Heemskirk.
Boy, a lot of contact there. No call. Guidry goes in strong. A little out of control. The officials gave the call in that case to Heemskirk. Redbird staying with that matchup zone defensively. It's been more effective in trying to slow down the Braves. The key here is they need to try to identify where the rebounders are if there's a shot taken.
Lawrence Wright threw the ball away. And the Redbirds get it back. And now Daniel Ruffin will come back in for Bradley. He replaces Wright.
Well, in that situation with the lineup that Bradley had on the floor, they have a more of a postman or an inside ball game dominated lineup. Lawrence Wright finds himself out on the perimeter where he's not as accustomed to playing and really makes an unforced turnover.
Green out to Alexander.
Alexander hesitated that time because hasn't been as sharp on those last two shots.
Now it's Gordon in traffic.
Good pass off the screen. Gordon, again, that slip screen that time, goes straight to the basket. He's got such a nice soft touch inside.
First 2 points for the Valley's leading scorer. Heemskirk the miss, tipped out. He went back and got his own shot. Couldn't get it to go down, though. Gordon clears for the Birds.
Great action on the boards by both teams. Illinois State just didn't give up in that situation.
Guidry, pull up three. No good. Somerville and Bennett go for it, and it's Bennett that comes down with it.
And Coach Porter Moser a little upset with Trey Guidry on that play for taking that shot in that situation. The Birds had a chance to cut the lead from under six, and just not very effective on that possession.
Foul is going to be whistled against Greg Alexander as he came on the weak side help on Somerville.
And Coach Porter Moser a little upset on that call. The official on the outside makes the call. I'm not saying it wasn't a foul. You see Greg Alexander get some of the hand on the play, but the official right underneath the basket did not make the call. It came from the official out on the wing.
So Somerville to the free throw line. Second leading scorer in the Valley and third leading rebounder. The last time, by the way, any single player led the league in scoring and rebounding in the same season was Ashraf Amaya of Southern Illinois back in 1992. It's a very difficult thing to do, lead the league in scoring and rebounding. Split the free throws, Somerville did, and the Bradley lead is 7 at 28-21. And Somerville now with 8 points. Here's Green, stutter step, hangs from the free throw line and knock it down.
Tough shot that time by Vince Green at 5'8 going in the lane. You know you have the 7-foot Heemskirk there. Good recognition that time by Green. If Heemskirk comes at him, he's got the dump down pass to Gordon. If not, he's got the little short jump shot.
Green is playing with as much confidence as we've ever seen in his career. Alexander got a hand on it, and it's stolen by the Birds. Now it's Guidry in the front court, and he kisses it off the glass.
Boy, tough no call that time against Jeremy Crouch. He did a good job of getting in position defensively. Guidry was able to get it off the glass and in. Now the Birds cut that lead down to three.
And the crowd is on its feet. Somerville over a double team, missed it, tipped out, got his own rebound, put it back up, and got it in.
You got to get a body on him. He is such a good rebounder offensively.
Now it's Lorenzo Gordon. How about that move?
That was a big-time move inside.
Wow.
Two guys defensively. What a quick spin move that time inside by Gordon. You can see he can really get it going offensively, and he's taking control, taking charge out there on the floor.
Heemskerk is favoring one of his feet. You can see him as he's kind of limping off. That's why we have a stoppage in play here. And Heemskerk is hobbling over to the Bradley bench.
I love the way Gordon plays. He plays with a chip on his shoulder out there. And if he feels like the other team's getting the best of him, he's going to turn it up a notch. And that's what we've seen out of him the last few possessions.
Well, that was a terrific, terrific move around Somerville and Heemskerk. Under a minute to go here in this wild opening half. Bradley with a three-point lead in the ball. Bennett guarded by Guidry. Now it's Plank on Somerville. Pull-up jumper. Front of the iron, no good. Tipped out and controlled by the Birds. And they can hold for one as the shot clock is off. Seconds and counting left in the half. Bennett got a piece of it. Guidry flipped it up to Alexander. Six to shoot. Down to Gordon, who may have lost it out of bounds. Redbirds were trying to penetrate that time, and the pass trickled off of Gordon and out of bounds, and now with 2.2 to go, the Braves get it.
And not surprising in this first half that defense is what wins in the last play of the half on the offensive end for the Redbirds.
Crouch, long pass down the end, and it's out of bounds, so the Redbirds are going to get it all the way back underneath the Bradley hoop.
Nobody touched that ball in that situation for the Redbirds to get the ball out of bounds underneath their own basket. They know what they're going to do out of this situation. A set play, certainly don't need a timeout.
Right prior to that pass, Bradley was trying to get Lawrence Wright into the game, but he couldn't get to the scorer's table in time. And so one of their better leapers was not on the floor for that play. So now the Redbirds will get it back with 2.2 to go. And Alexander to trigger underneath the hoop. Gets it into Green. His shot is up and no good. And Gordon couldn't tip it in. Lorenzo Gordon had a good look at the tip, but he couldn't get it to go down. So neither team can capitalize on their final offensive possession. And we're at the half with Bradley leading Illinois State 30-27.
A little stairway going down to my deck, and then I was going to make kind of a breezeway through here.
She's building on Ocean View property that she purchased in an auction, and by California standards, she got a steal.
I think I paid like $50 for all of the land entirely.
And if you're wondering how you can cash in on this land sale, you should know that what Fleming purchased is virtual land in a 3D computer world called Second Life, a place that Fleming and some other 15,000 players or residents are co-creating as I speak, a world limited only by their imagination.
They're building their dream homes. They're creating their avatars the way they imagine themselves. They're creating their fantasies.
Fleming, a freelance web designer, is using those skills to create her make-believe world. On the screen, Fleming's avatar, or computer-generated persona by the name of Belle Muse, is a 20-ish black woman with short, spiky hair and tight jeans. Her creator is 39, with shoulder-length hair. Still, there is an uncanny resemblance.
Oh, thanks. Kinda. You know, but obviously an idealized, cellulite-free version of me.
We have a very high percentage of women who are playing, and many of those women are in their 40s and 50s.
Robin Harper is a vice president at Linden Lab, the creators of Second Life.
There are many people who come to Second Life to see their friends. They socialize, they go to parties, they have people over to their houses.
Using Linden Lab servers, players have fashioned multi-million dollar homes, casinos, dance clubs, even shopping malls. They pay a one-time membership fee of $9.95 to get in, but if they want a house where people can visit, they have to buy land, which they can purchase from Linden Lab or other residents who are flipping the virtual real estate for a profit. Everything residents design, they own. So real commerce is developing with close to 1 million transactions a month, trading virtual Linden dollars for U.S. dollars and selling everything from designer homes to designer clothing.
I recently did a series on the fashion designers in Second Life.
James Au, a freelance journalist in real life, is an embedded reporter by the name of Hamlet Linden in Second Life.
Several of our top fashion designers actually make part of their real-world living by...
Back at Redbird Arena, Illinois State and Bradley with the Braves leading 30-27. Kurt Pegler, Matt Taphorn with you. Crazy first half, a lot of energy. Both teams probably slugging it out, much like a heavyweight fight here in the opening half, huh?
As expected with these two teams, anytime you get them together on the floor, it's going to be a knockdown, drag-out battle. But Illinois State, the key was losing Greg Dillegard early on. He's such an effective defensive player, especially against a guy like Marcellus Somerville. We talked about the versatility he has. Dillegard's athletic enough to stay with him out on the floor, but certainly physical with him enough inside. And we get Neil Plank in there trying to guard him. He's just not as effective as Greg Dillegard is. With two fouls, he had to go out of the ball game. We'll see if that makes a change or a difference in the second half.
30-27, Bradley leads Illinois State at halftime. We're going to chat live with Boomer Grigsby, the ISU football All-American, in a few minutes when we come back at Redbird Arena.
There are designated mature-rated areas where, well, consenting adult avatars can be intimate. Greta Fleming says in these areas...
You can be naked, and that you can use strong language, and that you can engage in risque behavior.
Perhaps we should take a look at some PG-rated sports instead.
So where is the snowboarding taking place?
Greta Fleming's avatar, Belle Muse, and her 3D friend, Catherine Omega, are heading for the ski slopes. There's snow, pine trees, in the distance, some deer.
Cool! We got snowboards! And you can hear the sound of the snowboard on the snow. Ah, this is cool! Yeah, I don't think I'd be this good in real life.
Oh, look out for that tree.
Oh. Yep.
Well, she can always relax those injuries in the hot tub of her Ocean View home. Gloria Hillard, NPR News, Los Angeles.
Back in the real world, Alex Patsavas listens to practically every album that will be released in coming months and decides which ones to use in the TV projects she works on. Even though she has all that new music at her fingertips, Patsavas finds she's often drawn to cover versions of old favorites.
My favorite covers are almost always classic tracks reworked by compelling new artists who make them undeniably their own. I wish I could just make you turn around. Like Phil Collins' Against All Odds. It was a huge hit composed for a 1984 movie of the same name. Since then, it's become a prom and karaoke staple the world over. Incredibly, 20 years later, it's back. Reimagined by the Postal Service, an emo indie supergroup, the song simply soars. So take a look at me now. There's just an empty space. And there's nothing left here to remind me. Just a memory of your face. Ben Gibbard of Death Cab for Cutie and Figurine's Jimmy Tamborello sent each other beats and lyrics. Through what else? The Postal Service. They do a beautiful job with this oldie but goodie. Take a look at me now. Another new cover, Holiday Road, was originally composed by Fleetwood Mac's Lindsey Buckingham as the theme for National Lampoon's Vacation. It's hard to believe that we first discovered the song and Wally World in 1983. But Matt Pompier takes this forgotten gem and gives it new life. Jack be nimble, Jack be cruel. Here, the Brooklyn-based indie quartet do what they do best, create a beautiful, lush soundscape. Matt Pond covers his composition with the sweetness and tunefulness that has become his trademark. 14 years before Vacation, Bob Dylan's album Nashville Skyline hit the American public, and the single Lay Lady Lay started the country rock genre. Now Magnet, featuring songstress Gemma Hayes, turns Dylan's simple, sexy classic into a tender yet suggestive duet.
Stay, lady, stay. Stay while the night is still ahead. So maybe I'll stay. Stay while the night is still ahead.
Evan Johansson, Magnet singer, creates an unforgettable version that should be played at wedding receptions and anniversary parties for years to come. Of course, not every cover song is for slow dancing. The Eagles of Death Metal do a raucous re-record of Stuck in the Middle with You. Their version, retitled Stuck in the Metal, is a latest of many takes on the 1973 hit, originally performed by Steeler's Wheel. We can thank Quentin Tarantino for the incredibly powerful use of this track in Reservoir Dogs, and the Eagles for the really bad rock pun.
Well, you started off with nothing and you're proud to tell a self-made man.
Finally, there's Buddy, a Portland-born singer-songwriter who delivers a wonderfully dark version of Kalisa's Top 10 hit Milkshake with a big wink. Inspired to do his own version after hearing the Neptunes track written for Kalisa, this indie version has since become a regular on my personal playlist. Despite listening to so many amazing original songs from my work, I am still such a sucker for a great cover. The possibility of an inspired reworking of a familiar gem gets me every time.
You can hear full-length tracks of some of Alexandra Patsavas's favorite cover songs at npr.org. That's All Things Considered from NPR News. I'm Jennifer Ludden.
Support for NPR comes from the Alzheimer's Association, encouraging Americans to learn about ways to reduce the risk of Alzheimer's disease, on the web at alz.org. From the W.K. Kellogg Foundation, from vision to innovative impact, 75 years of philanthropy. And from Prudential Retirement, a Prudential financial business with retirement plan solutions for more than 6,000 organizations and 3 million participants. Prudential Retirement. This is NPR, National Public Radio.
You've been listening to All Things Considered here on Smart Radio, WCBU. Good evening, it's 5 o'clock. Stay with us for Prairie Home Companion coming up in just a moment. This week, Garrison...
...be the most decorated football player in Illinois State University history, All-American linebacker. Congratulations on all the postseason accolades that you've had. I know you've kept yourself busy since the end of the season. You played that East-West Shriners game. You're getting yourself ready for the NFL draft, aren't you?
It's part of it. It's whatever it takes. It's a never-ending process.
And you're in Georgia now training. Is that right? How's that going?
I'm in Atlanta training with Chip Smith, Brian Urlacher's trainer down there. Every year he takes 30, 40 guys and just draft preparation. Just wake up with the sole purpose of getting bigger, faster, stronger.
Yeah. And that's really is the goal, and that's what you're doing now. You said you ran a 4.43 40, is that right?
Yes, sir. I got down there and they put about 10 pounds on me within about 2 weeks.
Is that right?
And lowered the 40 already, you know, close to half a tenth, and he thinks he's going to shoot it down a little bit even farther. So,
wow.
Got to do it on game day, though. You know, you got to do it at the combine.
And it's such an inexact science, this whole draft thing. So people might be saying you're a third round pick, you're a fourth round pick. You really don't know, do you, at this point?
You have no idea. I mean, a lot of people pay too much attention to the internet and even analysts. I mean, most of them don't even know what they're talking about. Or they're remotely close and they might have a general idea. But I mean,
like I said, you can go, you can think you're going to go in the second, not get drafted at all, or vice versa. You know, not think you're even going to get drafted and get picked up, you know, first, second day.
Yeah, and the combine, which is coming up in a couple of weeks, that's really a big time. 3 or 4 days, all the scouts are there. You work out in front of everybody. That's a make or break time, isn't it?
Well, the combine's real important for me, being from a small school. The Shrine Game, you know, helps show that I can play at the same speed with the so-called big school boys. You know, and so I had to go out there and handle that thing a little bit. And the combine, though, was where they'll interview. I'll do all the interviews with all the teams. I'll run the short shuttle, the three cone, do the 225 bench press test and the 40 and the vert and, you know, a series of drills. And just basically it's a meat market. You just showcase your talents.
Well, best of luck. We know that you'll represent Canton and Illinois State University very well.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Boomer Griggs, the All-American linebacker for the Redbird football team. Back with more in a minute.
Coming through that door. It's Saturday and the band is playing. Honey, could we ask for more? Coming to you live from the Fitzgerald Theater here on Exchange Street in St. Paul. It's a live broadcast of A Prairie Home Companion, presented by American Public Media, produced by Prairie Home Productions. With Rich Dworsky back here and the guys' all-star shoe band chunking away, Mr. Johnny Neiman down here and Pat Donahue on the guitar. Our radio acting company, Sue Scott, Jim Russell, and Mr. Tom Keith. Tonight's show brought to you by Land's End, the people who put a complete line of casual clothing at your fingertips at www.landsend.com. And also by the Sleep Number Bed by Select Comfort, the bed that lets you and your companion adjust the mattress firmness for your exact preference, your sleep number. It's a special show, Love Songs. Prudence Johnson joins us tonight, and here to sing love songs and also to help us observe the birthday this week of Franz Schubert, the Vocal Essence Ensemble Singers with Philip Brunel, director. Well, it's been a big week. The State of the Union address here this last week. Always good to hear his view of how things are going. Social Security in trouble, I guess. Couldn't be so unless, you know, I mean, he couldn't be wrong about this, would he? Gonna go bankrupt by 2042, he says, which it may, depending on how many nations we bring freedom to in between now and then. Good. But that's not why we're here. We're here to talk about love and to talk about Franz Schubert, born in 1797 on the 31st of January, a great Viennese composer, a great man who loved women. You pretty much have to in order to die of syphilis. And
it's you, 4 out of 5 from the foul line. Actually, that's the other way around. Bradley's 4 out of 5 from the foul line. And the three-point shooting is the other way around as well. We've got those mixed up for you there, but both teams with 10 turnovers. Let's take a look at the first half highlights. We'll start with the Braves.
Again, Jeremy Crouch driving hard to the basket, but Brandon Heemskerk was huge off the bench for the Braves. Had 8 points in the first half, 3 offensive rebounds. But certainly their go-to guy is Marcellus Somerville. He had 9 first-half points, the up-and-under move against Neil Plank, and you see this happen very frequently in the first half as Somerville scoring against Plank or Heemskerk inside. Heemskerk huge off the bench, hits the big shot there from the free-throw line, and again, Somerville taking baseline against Plank for 2 of his 9 points in the first half. For the Redbirds, Greg Alexander got him going with the big three-point shot, and then Trey Guidry found the opening, knocks down 3 of his 9 points in the first half. Guidry again from the corner. And then Vince Green gets open from the three-point line. Green had a big first half with 7 points. And then in transition, Green again taking it on his own to get to the basket and lay it in again for 2 of his first half 7 points.
The leading scorers for Bradley, Marcellus Somerville has 9 and Heemskerk with 8. Redbirds are led in scoring by Trey Guidry's 9 and 7 points from Vince Green. And we are set for second half action here. Redbirds start with a basketball, and it's a three-point Bradley advantage. Here's Gordon. His first shot is blocked by Patrick O'Brien.
And that's where O'Brien can be so effective, and there he's so long at 7 feet. Just maintains his ground, just gets those big hands up. Gordon trying to get over the top, just unable to, and O'Brien with the big block to start the second half.
Both teams start the second half with the same five that opened the game, and Bennett's three-point shot is no good.
Bennett was a little surprised to find himself that open. He really had Trey Guidry draped all over him in the first half, really held him ineffective for the first half.
And another rejection. Boy, the Braves do a wonderful job of blocking your shot, and they're trying to pull Trey Guidry out of the bench.
Yeah, this time it's Somerville coming over and helping out. You can see a little contact underneath that time. No call. The play happened up top. And Somerville with the block. So two possessions, two blocks for the Braves on the defensive end.
Now Bradley leads the Valley in blocked shots. And that's part of their defensive repertoire. When you've got a couple of guys that are 7 feet tall and you've got a leaper like Lawrence Wright, and in that case, Marcellus Somerville, you can see why they are so profound at the block shot. 3-point Bradley lead. 2 seconds on the shot clock. Trey Guidry has to kind of force up a shot from the corner.
Not very good execution that time by the Redbirds offensively.
And now it's Jeremy Crouch. His three is no good. The ball is tipped up, and it's Vince Green that gets it for Illinois State. Ahead of the pack is Greg Alexander, and he drew a foul.
Well, you got to give Alexander credit for taking it hard to the basket there in that situation, too. He's been more accustomed to setting himself up on the perimeter, takes it in strong against Crouch, draws the foul against Ruffin, and you see Dillegard and Gordon both going strong to the offensive boards.
Two shots upcoming now for Alexander, who has started 104 of the 108 Illinois State games in which he's played. J.J. Twy comes in to replace Jeremy Crouch.
And you look at Greg Alexander, averages about 6 points a ball game. You think, well, isn't there somebody else that might uproot him from the lineup? But he plays so hard with such heart out there. Defensively, he really digs in and tries to get you out of your game on the offensive, and that's why he started so many ball games.
Full court pressure by the Redbirds. Almost came away with a steal, but Ruffin will walk the ball up the floor. Yeah, with Alexander, I mean, he's the definition, really, of a blue-collar guard. Somerville lobs to Bryant, and there's going to be a foul, and it's going to be against Gordon.
And that may have been a foul in that situation, but I tell you what, it really did not affect the play. The pass was errant in the first place. O'Brien was not going to get that. Tough foul against Gordon, although he went through the first half without a foul, so just his first one in the ballgame.
Each team with an early foul here in the second half. Tony Bennett left open. No good. His long rebound tipped out and controlled by Dillegard. Dillegard strapped with two fouls and spent most of the first half on the Redbird bench.
Birds just haven't found an angle yet to get the ball into Lorenzo Gordon inside. He's working hard against Patrick O'Brien. O'Brien staying on the high side defensively.
And so Bennett's first foul is Bradley's second team foul here in the half. Redbirds shooting for their first lead since 3-0. Here's Guidry's three. That's good.
Well, the Redbirds take the lead in a big way. Guidry was a couple of steps behind the three-point line, got himself squared up. Really quick release at the top, was able to knock down the big shot.
Guidry now with 12, the crowd back into it. Illinois State has a two-point lead at 32-30. Somerville with Dillegard on him. Kisses it off the glass to tie the game.
Just a quick first step by Somerville in that situation. Had Dillegard on him. Dillegard really got up in his face, and he was able to get around him and get to the basket.
A terrific pass from Alexander into Dillegard, who cashes in.
Great baseline feed. Led Dillegard right to the basket. Was able to get the ball up. Nice little jump hook and up off the rim and in for Dillegard. First 2 points in the ball game for Greg.
Somerville around a double team, and he drew a foul. It might be the second on Lorenzo Gordon. It will be.
Yeah, just too aggressive that time, and really didn't get his hands up on the play as much. Still had his hands down a little bit in that situation. Dillegard really had good position down on the block, but as Gordon comes over, and we'll see this here, he gets his hands down low, and that's where the foul's called. He didn't get his hands up quick enough.
And so Somerville to the free throw line. Boy,
Go ahead, Kurt.
I just said last year, Somerville really, really hurt the Redbirds in their two regular season meetings. He averaged 20.5 points a game against the Birds.
He's just a big-time player. He steps up big in big games. The point I was going to make about Gordon not getting his hands up in time, that's one thing that Coach Porter Moten stresses defensively, is show your hands to the official. Don't let him see that your hand is anywhere near the offensive player.
After the free throw makes, Somerville now with 13 to take over the leading score runners in the game, and we're back even at 34. Kurt Pegler, Matt Taphorn with you for Illinois State and Bradley here on News Channel 31. It's Guidry. Missed it, got it back. Now Green left open. Three from the top of the circle's good.
Big shot there, and again, that's the type of attention that Trey Guidry draws. The first shot wasn't very good. Delagarde got a good hand on it, knocked it out. But again, the attention that Trey Guidry draws allows Vince Green to get open, knock down that big three.
Green has been red hot from the three-point arc. He's made 12 of his last 17 three-pointers here in the conference. And it's Gordon with the defensive board. And Vince Green just turned it over. He wanted to make a pass, and he got it caught in his arm.
Yeah, that's the right call in that situation. Again, Vince just got ahead of himself on that play. Had two options on it. He had Guidry open in the right corner, had Alexander on the left wing, and really indecisive on who he wanted to complete that pass to. First turnover in the second half for the Redbirds.
Alexander and Gordon to the bench. Dana Ford and Ronnie Carwell in for the Redbirds.
I like J.J. Twy is in for Bradley. For the Redbirds, getting Gordon out of the ballgame. He's picked up two quick fouls here in the second half. Try to get him out on the defensive end when you have the opportunity to put Ronnie Carwell in the ballgame.
Ruffin gives it up to Twy with Ford on him, 12 on the shot clock. Bennett, kick out to Ruffin, three ball, that's good.
Yeah, that'll happen when Dana Ford lunged with that pass. When you're going to lunge on the top of the key, you've got to come up with the ball, and that's what Coach Porter Moser is yelling at Dana Ford coming down the floor.
Ruffin's 15th three ball of the season. Guidry missed the shot, tipped in by Carwell.
Ronnie Carwell does so many good things for the Redbirds off the bench. He doesn't get a lot of minutes, but when he's in there, he's very effective.
And typically, he really earns his stripes on the defensive end. So when he can come up with a terrific offensive play like that, it's such a bonus. He's got such a big body. Tough shot by Somerville.
Very good shot. No call by the officials. Delagarde got a little bit of the body on that play. He's really in the zone right now and taking it at the Redbirds.
Green tried to get that pass in, and look at Delagarde tipped out of bounds by Somerville. Great start to the second half, and we're all even. Bradley and Illinois State, 39 all from Redbird Arena. Conference standings brought to you by Edward Jones, with more than 130 years of experience helping individuals build financial security. Edward Jones, investing in you and your dreams. You see, the Redbirds are right in the thick of the Valley race behind Wichita State and Southern Illinois. Bradley at 4-7, trying to get itself back in the right direction in the Valley race.
Well, and certainly a game like this gives them that opportunity. When you beat teams ahead of you, you have an opportunity to certainly move up, and they've really brought their game today. Both teams now shooting 16 out of 37, 43% in the ball game. We're all knotted up, not surprising.
Braves are in a zone defense now.
Gidrick kind of standing offensively in this situation, typically in his zone. You want to take advantage of that, get to the openings, and knock down a shot.
And he knocks down a three, and Trey Guidry is starting to heat up now.
And he knocked down that shot with the defensive guy draped all over him. So typically in a zone, you try to find some of the creases and get yourself open for an easy look. That time he was able to come off the dribble and raise up above the defense and knock down the shot.
Somerville guarded by Dillegard. Tried to get it to O'Brien. Vince Green tried to save it and tried to throw it off of O'Brien, and it's out of bounds, and the officials are trying to figure out who's going to get it.
Yeah, O'Brien that time jumped right over the ball as Vince Green was trying to throw it in off of him. But again, that double team down low against Somerville, he's going to draw a lot of attention. Guidry did a good job of rotating over that time to deflect the ball. Illinois State does not come away with the ball. Again, Bradley maintains possession.
Somerville missed it. Carwell clears for the Redbirds.
Great job by Carwell. Good box out. Gets the rebound on the block against Patrick O'Brien.
3-point Redbird lead. ISU with the basketball. That's Dana Ford guarded by Jeremy Crouch. Guidry draws some attention. He hangs, he fires, he missed it. It's Carwell that comes up with it. He floats it back in. How did he get it in?
That shot was even blocked. Patrick O'Brien got a piece of that. It's just Carwell is always in the right place at the right time. Just a great job off the bench. Big minutes by Carwell.
And 4 big points for Ronnie Carwell. Ruffin. He was bodied up that time by Vince Green.
Boy, this is the game within a game. You can see Green and the senior against Ruffin, the freshman, jawing at each other out there. Green challenged Ruffin to take it at him, and he did and was able to draw the foul in the ball game. That's going to be Green's second foul.
Michael Renbert has come into the game for Patrick O'Brien. You notice that both coaching staffs are wearing tennis shoes today. It's a nationwide effort in solidarity for the Coaches Against Cancer movement. So both the Bradley and ISU coaching staffs are wearing tennis shoes with their suit and ties. Marcelo Somerville, meanwhile, still hot. He knocks down the jumper. He has 17 now in the game.
I'll tell you, he is so good out there on the floor. He can score from anywhere. Perimeter, inside, you really have to honor him from anywhere on the floor.
Dillegard with Rembert on him. Now Green. Penetrate, pull-up jumper, no. And Ronnie Carwell tipped it up and in again.
I guess that's the Redbirds' version of Brandon Heemskerk off the bench. Carwell now with 8 big points in the ballgame.
Somerville is double-teamed. Jump pass over to Ruffin. Now Twy, top of the circle. His three is no good. Dillegard clears for Illinois State.
Carwell needs a breather out there. He's struggling a little bit to get up and down the floor, but what a great effort by him off the bench.
Alexander, his three is no good. Dillegard goes and gets it. Now Ford tries the three. That's no good.
Yeah, just really didn't want to shoot that shot initially. Second-guessed himself, was still open, and then took it. Really hesitated in that situation. He should just move the ball.
Terrific basketball game here at Redbird Arena. 46-41. Illinois State the lead, 11 and a half to go here. 10 to shoot for Bradley. Ruffin, his pull-up three. Front of the iron, no good. Rembert offensive board, swatted out of there by Carwell, but a foul.
Oh, I tell you, you gotta love Ronnie Carwell going after it as aggressive as he did, but that's why he was calling for the foul. He got a lot of ball in that situation, but you can see he comes down so aggressive, the aftershock was where he picked up the foul.
what a huge lift he's given the Redbirds with 8 points off the bench, and ISU has a 5-point lead over Bradley.
John, yeah. Take your time.
From a year ago, and he's so athletic now, at least more so than he was a year ago, isn't he?
I tell you, he just finds a way to get the ball around the basket. He's got 4 baskets in the ball game, all off offensive rebounds. Just gets himself to the bucket, and you see he's always getting his hands up around the rim. Just great effort by Ronnie Caldwell. You can see him on the bench, a little exhausted out of his minutes that he was in the ball game, but I tell you, he really gave the Redbirds a lift.
Well, at 6'10", 250, he's got such a big body out there, and has really given the Redbirds a nice lift off the bench. Michael Rembert to the free throw line now for the Braves.
Well, the scenario there that you also allowed Lorenzo Gordon, who picked up 2 quick fouls in the first half, to rest a little bit on the bench. Now you've got 11 plus minutes left in the ball game. You've got a fresh Gordon in there with only 2 fouls.
Rembert misses both free throws. That young man had 3 blocks against the Redbirds in last year's game in Peoria.
And interestingly, you have Marcellus Somerville out of the ball game now with Plank in there, who's very effective at scoring against him in the first half. Somerville catching a break right now in the second half.
That's Plank, the miss. Twy goes and gets for the Braves. Bennett, Twy, Rembert, Danny Adams, and Lawrence Wright are the 5 on the floor for Bradley. It's Guidry, Gordon, Plank, Vince Green, and Greg Alexander for Illinois State.
Boy, it looks like Wright is really uncomfortable with the basketball out on the floor. He's almost had 2 turnovers.
And Rembert walked.
No basket traveling, Redbird ball.
And Patrick O'Brien's coming back in for the Braves now. He'll replace Rembert.
It's interesting, though, when you see the Braves offensively, they try to attack it right at Neil Plank as soon as they get the ball, whether it's Somerville or, in this case, Lawrence Wright. And that time, Wright just wasn't as comfortable with the ball on the offensive end.
Vince Green penetrates, his pass intended for Plank, comes right back to him, and he lost it, and it's O'Brien that comes away with a steal.
Boy, he was mugged down there on the baseline. No call by the official. Vince Green really got in there. Neil Plank just has not made as much of a contribution off this bench in the ballgame, and he's been so effective for the Redbirds lately.
Bennett, fadeaway, tough shot. Wright, the offensive board.
And that's where Wright is very good. Those long arms, goes to the offensive glass well, and he's got such quick jumping ability, springs back up to the basket in a hurry.
He's coming off his first career double-double, a 14-point, 12-rebound night against the Salukis on Wednesday. 3-point Illinois State lead. Here's Plank, gives it up to Alexander now. Right back to Plank, and he's fouled. What a pass from Alexander.
Excellent pass in that situation again. They're trying to get the ball inside, create a little inside-out action. This time the good give and go by Greg Alexander, Neil Plank going down the lane. You can see the foul from behind against Tony Bennett.
substitution for the Redbirds, Greg Dillegard.
Twy and Adams go back to the Bradley bench, and Ruffin's back in now. And Somerville has re-entered the game as well.
Bradley with, again, their bigger lineup on the floor with both Wright and Somerville along with Patrick O'Brien. See how the Redbirds match up on the defensive end.
We are approaching the 9-minute mark left in this one. Redbirds with a 3-point lead in the basketball. 15 on the shot clock.
Boy, he got
Guidry
fouled
got
up top.
Fouled. He's going to get 3 free throws out of it.
Absolutely. Boy, bad foul in that situation by Bennett. The foul, not only a jump shooter, but a guy taking a shot from a couple steps behind the 3-point line. A little bit in desperation as well. Redbirds just really didn't get into their offensive sets very quickly. And on that situation, Bennett too aggressive on the defensive end.
And so Guidry, who by the way had 6 assists against Drake in the Redbirds' road win on Tuesday, will go to the free throw line. That's something that's overlooked in his game, as he's also done a better job this year distributing the basketball.
I'll tell you what, if the amount of trash talking in the game is any indication that its rivalry is back to its rarest form, it's back. Because you see all the players going back and forth out there, and it's not, you know, how's class going? How's your girlfriend doing? It's, you know, you acted on that play,
is
or
that
I'm
right?
Coming after you next time down the floor. It's in full force.
Substitution for the Redbirds, Neil Plank back in.
Plank comes in to give Vince Green a breather. And Guidry's going to get one more free throw. Guidry already now with 14 double-digit scoring games this season, and he's sitting at 17 here this afternoon. He and Somerville are tied for game-high honors in scoring. And Illinois State's lead is back up to 5 at 48-43. Under 9 minutes to go.
And Gordon still stuck on 4 points in the ball game.
Ruffin, that's his second 3 of the half.
Good ball movement that time by the Braves offensively. Ruffin just got his feet set on the line, got squared up, and a good release at the top of the shot.
It's a 2-point Redbird lead now. Plank with Ruffin on him.
Birds still struggling to get in their offensive sets.
Give and go with Gordon. Lost it. Dillegard got it. He puts it up and missed it. That almost worked out all right because Dillegard had the ball at point blank range. But now Bradley shoots for the tie. Here's O'Brien. Little floater. That's a second little hook that he's hit. He hit one early in the game, and now he's tied this basketball contest up.
Yeah, and you're not going to get up and block that shot. O'Brien at 7 feet gets those long arms up there extended. Nice little soft shot. Little jump hook inside.
And Porter Moser calls timeout. He wants to regroup here because the Braves have tied this game at 48. We'll step aside. 7:55 to go here at Redbird Arena, where Bradley and Illinois State are tied at 48.
All the exertions of the week really were justified and were a source of joy. Well, there, he said it. I wish I had, but anyway, he did. Sing with us. Sing a little hymn here, won't you all?
Thank you.
48. Patrick O'Brien showing a nice soft touch here, Matt.
Yeah, and again, inside from block to block, he's very effective, that little jump hook, and very strong, good long arms. Got a great touch on the ball inside. Great looking freshman. He's really going to be something for teams to battle with in the Valley for a few years to come.
Well, he leads Bradley with 5 double-doubles on the season and is trying to become the first freshman to ever lead the league in rebounding. He's the current leader in the league at 7.7 boards a game, but no freshman has ever finished the year atop the rebounding charts. 48 all, under 8 minutes to go here.
The Braves
have back in the game.
Really picked it up defensively and haven't allowed the Redbirds to get into their offensive sets, and that's where they've struggled.
Here's Greg Alexander for 3. No good. Went and got his own rebound, put it up, and drew a foul.
See if that's on Wright or on O'Brien. Boy, and Lorenzo Gordon got hit in the head. He's bleeding.
It's on O'Brien.
It is on O'Brien. Watch it come down in this situation. You got Lorenzo Gordon has blood coming from his corner of his eye.
So that'll be the 3rd foul against Patrick O'Brien. And there's an official's timeout on the floor. We'll remind you that our next televised game comes your way next week at this time, a 4:05 start when the Redbirds welcome Northern Iowa to Redbird Arena. That's the 12th of February, 1 week from today. Another late afternoon start, 4:00 for Illinois State and Northern Iowa. And the Redbirds certainly have a little payback in mind. The Panthers handled them pretty good up in Cedar Falls early in the season.
Redbirds trainer John Munn is tending to Lorenzo Gordon over on the bench. He was using his jersey to get some of that blood off of his eye, which immediately when he got hit started coming off. And I would imagine he's probably going to need to be stitched up a little bit. They have one of the team doctors over there, but he's certainly going to need a new jersey to get back in the ball game. You can't have blood on your uniform.
Well, what a great crowd here at Redbird Arena. The first sellout in 7 years. Bradley and ISU. We talk about it frequently as being the best rivalry in the Missouri Valley Conference, and the fans here today certainly have put a little extra energy in this afternoon's basketball game.
I tell you, people were talking about the Bradley-Illinois State game back in December even. That's the first time that's really happened in probably 5 or 6 years that I can remember. And, you know, that's great for the community of Peoria and Bloomington-Normal both. And when these two teams are at the top part of the league, the top half, it's great for the Valley as well because they're such an integral part of what goes on in the Missouri Valley Conference.
Joe Mitch from the Missouri Valley Conference is in attendance today. Usually somebody from the conference office takes in the I-74 game pretty much every year. They know how great the rivalry is and know how great the crowds historically are, and the Valley office usually well represented on game day as well. So the Redbirds send Ronnie Carlwell, Greg Dillegard, Trey Guidry, Greg Alexander, and Vince Green back on the floor. The Braves will counter with Marcellus Somerville, Lawrence Wright, Tony Bennett, Patrick O'Brien, and Daniel Ruffin. And again, that foul was credited and whistled against O'Brien, so that's his 3rd foul and the 5th on the team for the Braves here in the second half.
Like to see those seniors go into the free throw line in the guts of the game. Greg Alexander's knocked down every shot he's had.
Alexander cashes in on the foul shots. It's a 2-point lead for Illinois State, and a steal in the backcourt by Dillegard. Guidry thought about the 3. Now it's Alexander, and they'll reload the offense.
Really an unforced turnover that time by the Braves. Dillegard again with those long arms, so good defensively.
Guidry drives and scores.
What a great change of speed that time by Guidry. He kind of lulled Tony Bennett to sleep, thinking he was going to come back off the high screen at the top of the key and just exploded to the basket.
19 for Guidry. 4-point Illinois State lead. Bennett with Guidry on him. 10 seconds to shoot.
Look for Ruffin to get in the lane here against Guidry.
5 to shoot. Ruffin lost it. Ball on the floor. Shot clock violation.
There was no whistle by the officials.
Right.
Well, I thought that shot wasn't released in time. I think the players on the floor were a little surprised as well.
Yeah, everybody was standing around because they thought for sure it was a shot clock violation. Here's Guidry in traffic. Kept the ball alive, but there's going to be a foul.
Bennett's going to get a technical.
And it's a technical on Tony Bennett.
Well, that's tough in that situation. Bennett's certainly frustrated. But, you know, you call the foul in that situation, and immediately the officials are on top of the play. It's an easy call for a technical, but you really got a feel for Tony Bennett in that situation. Really played hard, really thought he went after a loose ball, and just was whistled for the foul.
And so right now Tim Hutchinson is giving an explanation to Tony Bennett.
And that's seven team fouls, so it'll be four free throws and possession for the Redbirds. They'll first get the two-shot technical, and then the one-and-one, and then get the ball out of bounds.
And Tony Bennett has now fouled out because he picked up one foul on the floor. A personal foul was his fourth, and then the technical goes against him as his fifth foul.
And Tony Bennett coming in this game was the second leading scorer for the Braves. Just the tremendous job that Trey Guidry did against him defensively really never allowed him to get an open look at the basket, and he leaves the game with only 2 points.
And so Tony Bennett will have to leave, and Vince Green, the Valley's best free throw shooter, will go to the free throw line. Jeremy Crouch has entered the game in place of Bennett. And now the technical will be shot first by Green.
We have a mic right next on that on the rim, and you can't hear any rim on those free throws. It's just all net.
So Green makes good on the two technical shots. And now the Redbirds get the basketball with Trey Guidry to trigger.
I'm surprised, I guess.
No shooting foul on that, and now the Redbirds are in the bonus from here on out.
Surprised Alexander wasn't at the line with one in bonus.
Green driving on Ruffin, and then hits the pull-up jumper. Four straight points, all by Vince Green on that possession. Why? Crouch guarded by Alexander. Somerville thought about the three. Kick out to Ruffin. Nine to shoot. Ruffin, his pull-up is no good. Somerville high up to get the rebound. He floated it in.
And Dillegard had to pick up Ruffin on the high ball screen and was late getting back to Somerville inside. Again, that just shows you the versatility of Somerville. Releases off that ball screen and goes right to the glass.
Great touch as he was kind of falling off balance to shoot that ball off the glass. 19 for Somerville. Guidry leaves it that time, man. Missed that time. Carwell had a good look at it.
Ball just sat up on the rim for Carwell. Good leave that time by Trey Guidry inside for Ronnie Carwell.
It's a six-point Illinois State lead. Making a three-point game now is Somerville.
And that's two straight plays where Ruffin has taken his man off of the screen set by Somerville, where Somerville comes off the screen and scores. Dillegard has got to let Vince Green get through that and stay on his man.
22 now for Somerville, and he's got that look in his eye. He just loves to play in this game against the Redbirds. And he just picked up a foul as he stepped out to guard Guidry.
Guidry gives him a little glare out of the corner of his eye on the play as well. Somerville a little aggressive defensively on that ball screen. He's really pumped up in this ball game, really getting the Braves back into it.
That's the second foul on Somerville. And again, it's bonus time now for the Redbirds. Here's that foul again as he stepped out on Guidry.
He saw that play coming all the way. He knew Guidry was coming off that high ball screen, that handoff by Dillegard, and just a little too aggressive on the step in.
Guidry's free throw got all of the rim that time and rolled in. Guidry is a 79% foul shooter. And Trey Guidry now with 21 points. It's the sixth time this year that Guidry has scored 20 more in a game for the Birds. crowd back into it. O'Brien, fadeaway, short. Dillegard tried to save, or I should say, it was Ronnie Carwell trying to save, and it's Bradley basketball.
Boy, and Carwell did such a good job of guarding O'Brien there on the block. He showed his hands, bodied him up on the shot. Actually might have gotten a piece of the ball. Greg Alexander just was unable to come in and grab the loose ball.
So a fresh 35 on the shot clock for the Braves, who immediately look to Somerville. Now it's Ruffin. Floater off the glass and in. Daniel Ruffin, a freshman, showing a very, very calm demeanor on that shot.
Well, I thought Somerville took steps inside as well. See Lorenzo Gordon coming back to the scorer's table as he was out for probably 8 minutes trying to tend to that cut, that open wound.
And Vince Green's pass to Dillegard goes out of bounds, and so Bradley will get it back. It's a three-point Illinois State lead. 3:49 to go here at ISU. Don't go anywhere. Redbirds lead the Braves 58-55.
Of the Cowboys, brought to you by Santa Fe brand food flavoring. If a diet of salt pork, hardtack, and grub is getting you down, add some cinnamon mocha or strawberry banana chino and liven it up. Now let's rejoin Dusty and Lefty for another exciting adventure.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, looks like we're coming into the cities here. Wyzetta, Minnetonka, Hopkins.
Yes, sir.
I bet Minneapolis is not too far ahead. I can smell the Thai cooking from here.
Wait a minute. I thought they had hot dish in Minneapolis.
Well, they used to have hot dish, but then the spices arrived, and now everything has a Thai or an Indian name on it. All the hot dishes all have garlic and cilantro on them, so.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. A hot dish is what I'm hoping to find in Minneapolis.
Huh?
With hot lips and a big imagination.
Now, wait a minute. Wait.
Yes, sir. I want to... What?
It's the wrong time of year for romance here, partner. I don't care if it is a thaw here in February. Just people still wearing too many layers of clothing to think about that.
Hmm.
By the time you get them undressed, they're not in the mood anymore.
Well.
Team's point guards during the last couple of minutes here, Matt.
And we talked about it being the game within the game. You have Vince Green at 5'8", Daniel Ruffin at about 5'9", both going head-to-head. Ruffin gets inside. Nice little fake pass against Ronnie Carwell, lays it off the grass. He's got 10 points in his first exposure to this I-74 series, the freshman out of Peoria.
Well, Jim Les said earlier this week he wasn't quite sure how his young team would react to their first exposure to the Illinois State Bradley game. But when you think about it, Jeremy Crouch and Daniel Ruffin both played on this floor in high school in super sectional games, so it's not like they're totally unfamiliar with these surroundings.
No, we've talked about this before. These guys coming out of high school have played in so many big games to this point that another big game is just another game to them. So as freshmen, they come in and people have maybe lower expectations for them, but when you come out of programs like they did in high school, they've certainly been exposed to this type of ball game.
And here is Crouch down the lane, and he flipped it in. His first basket of the afternoon.
Good awareness that time by Crouch. Coming off the screen, his defender was behind him, took it right to the hole. Sometimes when you're struggling on the perimeter, that's one way to get your offensive game going. Just take it to the basket and come up with an easy bucket.
And the freshman from Pekin makes it a one-point game. Illinois State 58, Bradley 57. Dillegard's going to get to the free throw line. Greg Alexander passes maybe as well as anybody in the league from the top to the bottom.
Great awareness again on this play. This is that slip screen we talked about so many times by the Redbirds. The guy setting the screen, if he senses that his guy is going to extend and help on the man coming out, he'll just immediately go right to the basket. Greg Dillegard was very effective that time. Dillegard, one of the best athletes on the team in terms of getting up over the rim, really took it hard and strong to the basket against O'Brien.
Yeah, there may not be a better guard at passing from the top to the bottom, as we mentioned, from the top of the circle to the bottom.
Boy, that was really
the first free throw. It was halfway down and it came out.
And Dillegard really has struggled on the season, shooting about 31% from the line, but that one really caught a lot of the rim. Unfortunately, didn't go down for the sophomore from Missouri.
Missed them both. And it's Somerville in the middle of all that comes down with it. Now the Braves can take the lead with a basket. 3 minutes to go here. Jim West wants a 30-second timeout.
Lorenzo Gordon back in the ballgame for the Redbirds. Surprised he has a little blood on his uniform. I'm surprised they haven't made him change that or, you know, at least put something over it. But, you know, 4 points in the ballgame with 3 minutes to play in this game, Redbirds still have the lead. Certainly have to feel fortunate with the leading scorer in the Valley, not necessarily having his A game today or having given the opportunities to bring his A game.
And we remind you that our next televised game here on News Channel 31, 1 week from today, Greg McDermott and the Northern Iowa Panthers come to town to take on the Redbirds. It's ISU in Northern Iowa next Saturday at 4:05 here on News Channel 31.
The Redbirds have certainly played well this year and been in many close games they've lost, but that game at Northern Iowa is one that really in the second half slipped away from them, and is probably one game that they could say they really were not in the game.
Under 3 minutes to go here. 58-57. Redbirds with the lead. Bradley with the ball.
Birds in the matchup zone. Again, the key here is to identify the shooters.
Daniel Ruffin, long three. Dillegar to get it for the ISU Redbirds.
That was certainly a jump ball opportunity, and I'll give my chances to Greg Dillegar at any time in that situation.
Vince Green down to Gordon.
Much more under control that time by Vince Green, getting the basket. Easy lay-in for the big fella inside.
Somerville spinning on the baseline, flipped it up, couldn't get it. Ball on the floor, Redbirds have it. 2 minutes to go.
Timeout.
And a timeout called by Porter Moser.
Vince Green has made a lot of plays in this ball game, been very aggressive attacking the basket, and I'd love to see that out of the point guard. This last time down the floor, he was much more effective getting the ball in the lane, drawing the attention of the bigger defenders and dumping it off to the big guy inside. Lorenzo Gordon with 2 of his 6 points in the ball game. Again, in this situation, draws the defense, Patrick O'Brien. Again, O'Brien with 4 fouls, which is key. Let Gordon slip in behind him for the easy lay-in.
And the senior from Chicago, Brother Rice, with 14 points and 4 assists this afternoon and playing with a very high level of confidence these last couple of weeks.
Absolutely. He's been a guy down the stretch of the game that's really taken upon his shoulders to get the Birds back into the ballgame or extend the game or even win it in certain situations from the line especially. But he's knocked out some big threes in a loss recently at Wichita and a victory, a come-from-behind victory at Drake.
Plank is in the game now for Dillegar. That's him with a basketball.
Gordon really riding Patrick O'Brien. Surprised the Redbirds don't really take advantage of Gordon in this situation to go right at O'Brien, who's got 4 fouls.
Vince Green lost it. Now it's Alexander from the corner. He missed the shot. It's tipped out, and it's Twy that comes down with it.
Boy, after Alexander hit that first three of the ball game, just hasn't been as sure of his shot. He's unable to knock down the open shot from the corner.
And now the chess game continues as Jim West calls timeout. As it stands now, each team with 1 full and 1 30-second timeout remaining. At this point, it's possession by possession.
And it is, and that's what we're seeing. Coach Porter Moser react to that scenario, and he's getting Greg Dillegard back in there on the defensive end. Certainly been much more effective against Somerville and going with Neil Plank on the offensive end. But again, I want to make the point that on the offensive end, the Birds really need to look to get the ball on Lorenzo Gordon. He's got Patrick O'Brien with 4 fouls. He had position on him one time, just couldn't get the entry pass from out on the perimeter.
All right, so we'll reset it for you. 1:28 to go here in regulation. Illinois State leads Bradley 60-57, each team with 1 full and 1 30-second timeout remaining, and Bradley has the basketball. It has been a whale of a contest. Ruffin down the lane, missed the shot. Vince Green comes away with it.
Yeah,
and he's fouled in the backcourt by J.J. Twy.
And Coach Jim Les looks at him in that situation, shakes his head. You can't foul him in that situation. Watch Twy come from behind, just comes up on the ball. The official right out on the wing just makes the play. But in that situation, Vince Green, the best free throw shooter in the Valley, one of the best in the nation, sends him to the line. It almost gives him a free 2 points.
Well, currently, you're right, Matt. He stands fifth in the NCAA in free throw percentage.
Ruffin had a great look at that shot, too, down the lane. Just wasn't able to connect, went a little hard off the rim. And Vince Green, who was guarding him, trailing him on the play, was the guy who came up with the rebound.
And Vince Green continues to do damage at the foul line like he's done all year for the Birds. Two free throw makes give him 15 points for the game and give the Redbirds a 5-point lead and a timeout by Jim Les. It's a 62-57 Illinois State advantage with 104 remaining.
Really look for Bradley to spread the floor again in this situation. Ruffin's been very effective at getting the ball penetrating, coming off ball screens, and they've been very successful in that ball screen, especially by Somerville. He scored a couple of big baskets, hit the big three from the corner, and was able to get free in the lane off a missed shot by Ruffin. But look for that two-man action out on the perimeter by those two players.
Well, folks, we hope that you've enjoyed this contest as much as we've enjoyed bringing it to you. A full house here at Redbird Arena to see the first of two scheduled meetings between Illinois State and Bradley. And this game has lived up to all the pregame hype. Bradley had an early double-digit lead as they really came out on fire in that first half, and eventually the Redbirds drew within three at halftime and took the lead in the second half, and the Braves have hung tough here. 1 minute to go. 62-57, ISU the lead, and Bradley the basketball.
They're switching all screens right now and staying with Somerville, wherever it is on the floor.
And Somerville's going to get three free throws out of it. He's fouled in the corner, attempting a three.
Well, I have to see that again. I thought Guidry did a good job of keeping his hands up high. He may have got him down low with the body, but Somerville really trying to lull you to sleep. He looks you off where he gets the ball in his hands and tries to get you on your heels and raise up for the shot. That time he's able to just draw his arm right through Guidry and pick up the foul.
Originally recruited by Iowa, signed with the Hawkeyes, but wound up transferring to Southwest Illinois College, and now has made his way to Peoria to play for the Braves, his hometown team, because he's from Peoria Central. The crowd is really, really into it and trying to distract the all-conference player here. He's missed his first two on this trip to the foul line.
Now they're finally getting Gordon out of the game because he has blood on his shirt. He's been in the game for 7 minutes.
Well, so
I think that wound is bleeding again. That may be part of the reason.
That might be it. If you've just joined us, he got scratched right above his eye and he had a bandage up there. And right now he's getting a little medical attention on that Redbird bench.
I think that wound actually, I think it was opened on him. I think for the time being they tried to just butterfly it closed and maybe attend to it after the ball game. But certainly in this situation they want to try to have him on the ball game. Not only the fact that he's their leading scorer, but he's a much better free throw shooter than either Dillegard or Carwell that might be put in the ball game.
So now they've got everybody back in place, and Somerville has one more foul shot coming. And that one he makes. 23 points now for Marcellus Somerville. It's the ninth time this season that he scored at least 20 in a game for the Braves. Guidry gets the inbounds pass, and he's hammered by Somerville right at the timeline.
Bradley Kyle, number 15, Marcellus Somerville, his third.
Good job again by Guidry. He's not afraid of the contact. Guidry's kind of got a football player's mentality about him, and Somerville is very strong and physical in there on the floor as well, but I really like Guidry's attitude out there. He doesn't back down from anybody. stares you down. You know, he's a fighter out there on the floor.
And so he's going to get a pair of free throw attempts here. And now some substitutions. Dillegard's coming back in for Carwell. Meanwhile, Crouch, Ruffin, and Danny Adams return now for the Braves. So again, we're substituting defense for offense and offense for defense here in the final 47.2. Excuse me, second foul shot is missed. 63-58, it's a 5-point game. Here's Ruffin, now Somerville. Crouch.
Green guarding Somerville out on the perimeter.
Jeremy Crouch spins, and how about that shot by a freshman off the glass?
Tough shot, Crouch, very effective. That's one of the surprising things that people don't realize about his ball game. He's a good 3-point shooter from the perimeter, but he's also very effective at taking it to the bucket.
Well, the Redbirds appeared to be defending that play very well, but the freshman from Pekin had it in his mind that he was going to take that shot, and he knocked it down.
Great spin move there on Neil Plank. A little bigger defender against him. Takes it hard. He's got two buckets here in the second half. Good job of taking it strong to the basket.
People in Central Illinois are very familiar with Jeremy Crouch, as he was an All-State performer at Pekin. He plays for Joe Stoner, his uncle. His father is an assistant coach on the Pekin team. Marshall Stoner, his grandfather, is a name that's long linked with Pekin Athletics. He's got a great bloodline there.
Absolutely. I tell you what, I saw Jeremy play all 4 years in high school, and people were wondering what kind of a player he was coming to Bradley, and I said, I'll tell you what, I wouldn't be surprised if he ends up being a 1,000-point scorer. He's just got that type of ability and versatility in his game. He's very effective from the perimeter, but as we saw there, he can score inside in the paint area, and he's always got a nose for the ball, and glad to see what he's accomplished in his first year at Bradley.
And now the Redbirds have been down this path before. Certainly they're going to want to try to get the ball in the hands of Vince Green, and typically Greg Alexander is the man on the baseline getting the ball inbounds. And again, this is an underappreciated art against full-court pressure to get the ball inbounds and to get it inbound to the right guy. Bradley is out of timeouts after this last timeout. The Redbirds have two remaining timeouts. Here's Green, they got the ball into him. And he's fouled in the back by Daniel Ruffin.
We saw Gordon back in the ball game as well. He got 10-2 on the bench rather quickly to get him in the ball game, just to get another free throw shooter in the game. But certainly for the Redbirds standpoint, they want to get the ball in the hands of Vince Green, Mr. Automatic, from the free throw line.
You saw that last shot of Lorenzo Gordon as he was walking down the floor. He's got that cut bandaged right above his eye. And now Green back to the free throw line. Earlier this season, he made 57 consecutive free throws, actually did it back to last year before that string was finally snapped in November. But he shoots it at 92%.
Again, for the Braves, look for Danny Ruffin to penetrate inside. And you have Crouch and now Danny Adams both in the game from the perimeter, along with Marcellus Somerville, who can knock down that 3-point shot.
Under 30 seconds to go. Ruffin down the floor quickly. Leaves it for Somerville. Lost the ball. It's on the floor. And Ruffin comes away with it. His long three is no good. Adams the rebound, and he's fouled.
That was a very long three in that situation, but good job by Adams to go strong to the basket, get that offensive rebound. Good action underneath. See Trey Gidrier come around from behind and pick up the foul, send Danny Adams to the line for two shots.
And so Adams, who has shot only two free throws all season, is going to go to the free throw line.
See, 4 out of 5 players on the floor right now from Bradley are all from Central Illinois. It shows you what effectiveness they've had in that area for a long time.
Gordon comes back in. Twy comes back in for Bradley. Dillegard out for Illinois State. Crouch out for Bradley. Adams gets the second now of his two free throws. The sophomore from Metamora, who missed almost his entire senior year of high school after a torn ACL and still had an opportunity to walk on and then get a scholarship for Bradley. And they're going to waive the free throw off, a lane violation against the Braves.
Said Lawrence Wright was in the lane too soon. Redbirds will maintain that four-point lead.
And Green gets the inbounds pass, and again Ruffin gets him in the foul. And two free throws here from Vince Green can really, really put a nail in this one.
I tell you, you can't say enough about Illinois State seniors this year. They have really rededicated themselves and recommitted themselves. They want to go out winners, and you see it in the way they play. Trey Guidry in the way he's playing down the stretch. Vince Green taking the team on his shoulders. Greg Alexander coming back from an injury, really playing effective, not only on the offensive end. You talked about his passing ability, knocking down some big shots, but primarily on the defensive end, really stepping it up another notch.
Well, Porter Moser challenged his three seniors, those three senior guards, to step it up this year, and boy, have they done it big time. Ruffin all the way down, he lays it in again. Bradley is out of timeouts. Guidry is fouled by Adams on the inbounds, and there's 10 seconds to go. It's a five-point Illinois State lead.
And what a win for the Redbirds to play on their home floor and have a game where your top guy is really not on top of his game for various reasons. Never really got in the flow of the game. And you got to credit Bradley somewhat for
Absolutely.
Taking him out of that.
Absolutely.
Certainly with a guy like Patrick O'Brien. And whenever he gets the ball, he's double-teamed. And really a lot of teams in the Valley are going to do that to him. But they've been able to withstand that and really come out in the second half and take over this ball game.
And credit the Redbirds here at crunch time once again getting the ball into the hands of the right guys to shoot fouls. If it's not Green, it's Guidry. If it's not Guidry, it's Alexander. They have the right guys at the foul line in the final seconds. A seven-point Illinois State lead in the final seconds of this one. Ruffin's shot is no good. It's tipped out, and it's Alexander that comes down with it. And the ISU Redbirds are winners over Bradley by a final of 69-62. A solid performance by the Redbirds, who, as we mentioned, were down by as many as 12 points early in the first half, but rode some momentum. Give credit to Ronnie Carwell, gave him huge minutes off the bench. 24 from Guidry, 20 from Green to offset a 23-point performance from Marcellus Somerville.
And really, what a great atmosphere for the Illinois State program. Really turning things around in a huge game like this, or your rivalry game, getting it done on your home floor in front of a sellout crowd, and they got three home games to follow it up.
Terrific college basketball atmosphere here and a wonderful game. Trey Guidry with 24 points, helping Illinois State win tonight 69-62. The Redbirds now 16-6 overall, a team that won just 10 games all of last year, and 8-4 in the league. Porter Moser saluting the student section in this full house here at Redbird Arena.
And Porter Moser getting over the 500 mark at Illinois State in his career as a coach, and just a tremendous job of staying with this team, keeping these guys focused, getting them bought into his system, and especially with seniors that have been in the program for a couple of years, does a great job of getting them bought in as well.
The final score again here from Redbird Arena, Illinois State 69 and Bradley 62. For Matt Taphorn and for our producer Steve Harris, this is Kurt Pegler.